All right, looks like we're looking ready to get going. I want to welcome everybody, first of all, to the Technology for On-Course Management session. I think I mentioned in the opening segments, by the way, my name's Dale Ratcliffe. I appreciate y'all coming in here and spending time with us today. I mentioned in the opening session that we really had some challenges when we were trying to decide exactly what do you present at a technology conference. You know, what can we really do that's going to benefit you as golf course owners and operators? And the definition of technology is so broad, I was a little concerned because it seemed like a lot of the sessions, a lot of the feedback we were getting from our committee and actually from members were really focused on using technology for marketing. But as we learned, and as what Scott talked about some in his opening presentation there, technology covers areas that are much more vast than just marketing, and particularly golf course operations. Now, this whole concept of the Internet of Things is really beginning to make a big impact on golf. And it goes beyond just our tee sheet point of sale systems and our pro shop management, but there's really a huge impact being made by technology out on the golf course. And it affects everything. It affects everything from golf cart fleet management to fertilization, irrigation controllers, equipment management, weather forecasting. You know, so many things are really vital to successful operation of our business. So we really wanted to do a session on technology that affected the operations of the golf course beyond just the tee sheet, marketing, and even general operations within Pro Shop. But it was a challenge because it's such a broad and vast field. We could have literally put more people up here talking about that than we've got out here sitting in the audience because there's so many different facets and so many different areas of that. And so I was tasked with kind of trying to put this session together because I was one of the big believers that we really needed something like this. So I can't tell you how happy I was when I found the gentleman that's sitting up here with us. Mr. Walt Norley is a technology guy. His background, I'm going to let him talk about that in a little bit, is ideally suited for what we're going to talk about here. The company he has, which is OnLink, was just recently renamed from OnCourse. OnGolf. He has done a great job of really working with all different types of technology and bringing that into useful information that you as golf course owners can utilize in managing your business and making it more efficient and more profitable. So we wanted to just kind of take this session and do something very different. Okay, this is not going to be just a presentation where we're teaching you something. I told Walt whenever I got to talk with him, what I really want to do is get it inside his head and just kind of prize it open and give us access to all of that information in there. So we're going to do this in kind of a fireside chat format, okay? The one thing is you'll notice we are kind of tight on the budget here. I requested a fireplace behind us, but apparently that didn't go through the budget committee. But, you know, we do want this to be very informal. The idea is, you know, it's very difficult from our side to know all of the challenges you may be facing at your particular facility. So I'm going to go through a series of questions that are kind of very broad-based in nature with Walt, just to let him start giving us some ideas and some concepts that we may not even be aware of as operators. You know, I've got one of my superintendents, by the way, I manage five courses in Charlotte, and one of my superintendents that I consider to be, he's an egghead. He's a real tech guy. He's into everything. But yet we're constantly finding out things that even he doesn't know about. You know, it's just very difficult for us to know all of the things that are available. So in the questions that I'm going to give Walt, he's going to respond to those. He's going to give us kind of a real broad overview. And I asked him also to kind of get down in the weeds a little bit, too, to go down granular and talk about some of the details of the things in these different applications of technology on course management. So he's going to be doing that. But it's also going to be very conversational as well. If you have a question at any point in time, don't worry about raising your hand and asking here, okay? We're here to provide information to you. And it doesn't matter what the subject might be. It doesn't matter what the topic might be. It can certainly be on Walt's company. It could be on somebody else's company. It could be on some technology that is new that none of us have ever heard of. And I can guarantee you, you're going to get some useful information out of our guests up here on the panel today. So with having said that, what I'd like to do is start off with just giving Walt a little opportunity. I'm going to let him talk to you a little bit about his background and everything, because Walt is, again, it's a very varied background. It really ideally suits him for this talk that we're having today, for you guys to be able to get some information out of him. So, Walt, if you would, tell him a little bit about your background and how you got to where you are.
Sure, thank you, Dale. Hi, everybody. How are you? Good morning. I have a unique background in that I've built six companies. I started as a young guy. I did my first one in my late 20s. you know, it's always been a little bit first of a kind, so it was to put the first hazardous waste, safe hazardous waste incinerator project in the state of Pennsylvania. Nobody had done that. At the time, Pennsylvania was shipping its hazardous industrial waste to Alabama, and Alabama said no more. And so, frankly, I went from that. We had great success, sold my interest in that, and decided to take on another first of a kind. I went out and developed in the alternative fuel space, and I developed a compressed natural gas fuel tank, which was very early. We had partnered with General Motors. It was all about making this vehicle really fleet vehicle back in 1992, 1993, so a long time ago, probably at the time. And it took me, I was just telling Mr. Dell, it took me to one of the most interesting parts of my career. It took me to Russia, because we went over to Russia to source advanced composites that would be a less expensive, ideally a higher strength fiber than what Saint-Gobain and Owens Corning were going for. They really had an oligopoly line around the world. And to make this tank lighter, stronger, cheaper, really was the solve. And to make a very long story short on that, I ended up spending 5 years in Russia when we were going through the revolution. We quickly understood that the compressed natural gas vehicle world was way too nascent. We were too far ahead of the market. So we ended up getting into the fiberglass business and selling that to literally Boeing floorboards, bow and arrows, golf shafts, skis, hulls on racing boats. You know, we just had a wide variety of applications. And the good news of that story was that I came out of Russia, which was a difficult place. I mean, I really saw things you can't imagine. 5 years later, not only my health intact, but also my bank account intact as well. So I was able to exit the business. I got into this business. Candidly, like a lot of entrepreneurs, and I think we have some in the room, I think whether it's this room, this building, the country, the world, I think what all entrepreneurs have in common, they're opportunists, so I'm an opportunist. B, within the opportunity, you're trying to either solve a problem or fill a void. And the golf thing came to me in 2003, had zero background, really didn't even know how to spell agronomy. And somebody had a patent for subsurface aeration. You guys have all probably heard of subair. And we went and designed a more efficient, lighter, less power intrusive unit. And I hired these great agronomers. And I'll tell you a couple stories about them. I hired what I call the Jack Nicholson agronomy guy, and Paul HLC's. Paul had done 6 masters, 5 U.S. Opens on 4 different venues, from Wingfoot to Oakmont to Congressional to Riviera, and created a mentoring tree. I think he has 150 to 160 head superintendents in the country out that came under his mentor working for him. So I started with this great agronomist, learned all these great things, and what was interesting, even though he was 65, 66 years old, and it goes to this whole talk here, he was interested in improving. He wasn't, geez, I'm the best at what I do. I don't have to do anything more. I don't have to take any more risk. In fact, I'm let's look at different ways to make this aeration system better. But the aeration system, as you probably guys know, has a lot of limitations. I asked Paul, what's the hardest decision you make every day? Whether you're at the Masters or Augusta or you're at Wingfoot or Riviera, what was the hardest decision? He said, that's an easy one. It's, how much water and when? And I said, well, how do you make that decision? And he said, you did this. And I said, you did that at Augusta, Jordan? You did that at Augusta, you did that. Right, look this one.
Yeah, there you go.
So that led to us developing, we pioneered the first wireless soil sensor system. And that was 2003, 2004, 2005, 2006. We spent $15 million to get it right. The hardware tech world is expensive. The challenge, which I'll speak to as we walk through, it's one of Dell's questions. The challenge is, how do you get your money back in this industry? How do you spend real R&D to innovate
make a difference where everybody gets, you know, intrinsic value out of it. I get a payback ag, where a lot of great products and technologies are developed because of the size of it, can come back in here. So we developed the first wireless soil sensor system. Candidly, got a pretty big fight with the guys from Toro about patent infringement, trade secrets, etc. Won that fight, and it's 2008, 2009. And so we took the perspective that the golf industry was under stress, and let's move into ag, which we did, and we moved into residential commercial for irrigation management. So, but in that time frame, so call that 2003 to 2010, I really garnered an appreciation for owner-operators, decision-makers in this space. Certainly met, I think I can candidly say I've been in probably 300-plus superintendent offices across the country and across the world, because we did a lot of stuff internationally as well. And a lot of great lessons learned. This came about, what we're doing right now with OnLink came about from my IBM experiences. So IBM brought me in as an executive advisor for the water space. You guys remember the Smarter Planet commercials with, I mean, they ran them before they even had a product. But I was part of their Smarter Cities group, and they had buckets. So you heard about the Internet of Things yesterday from the Verizon guy, very much the world that we're going to talk about today. And I'll bring it down so you can see the application, you know, for your golf course or your property. But they were doing the Internet of Things very early. Aggregated data for the city of Chicago, my water, my transportation, my traffic, my public health and safety. Put all that information in one place so people that have management, operational management of those silos can make better decisions because everything's in place. So I learned from that, and when I had exited the sensor business, one of the best things that ever happened to me is I went and worked with a private equity group out of New York, and we were looking at technology companies all over the country. And I've always been extremely myopic. I really don't care about anything else except for what I'm doing and what I'm building. And so really it was the first time in my entire career where I got exposed to just all these different solutions and all these different technologies and what works, what doesn't work, why doesn't it work. I'll tell you one thing in brief that I found out. And we looked at probably 175 companies in a year and a half, and we made offers on 22. And we made deals on 2. It's a very much fun of people, the biggest difference with people. So great technology, great solution, good market, good timing, but lack of leadership, lack of skill sets, doesn't move, you know, train doesn't move out of the yard. Average solutions, with really good people, win. So anyway, whatever you're doing, people always matter. Somebody had come to me from my IBM days and said, "Hey, Walt, we've got this group in Fresno, California, who won venture company of the year, and they're doing something for the ag world called OnFarm." And at this point in time, frankly, I was getting a little bored looking at companies and all that stuff. I wanted to go back in and get in the race. And I took a look at it. I kept in touch with my friends from the golf world who kept telling me, timing's right. You know, everybody's using this. You know, data's coming. You know, enablement, cloud enablement's coming. We'll talk through this when I show you this. And I said, really? I was a little bit skeptical, given what I was kind of pushing this rock up the hill, because we were just early with our sensors. And I liked what they were doing. And what they were doing with all these internet, and they were an Internet of Things company. They were aggregating all the key data points, putting them up in one place, and providing actionable insights. And the net value for the farmer was he was looking to quantify the optimization of his yield. Grape growers, almond growers, avocado, tomatoes, I was on all those farms. So I grabbed my golf guys, and the premise of being able to do that in the golf market, pretty intuitive, right? Weather, water, soil, camphor, equipment. The biggest difference, which we found out when we put our beta product out there, was that consumer being on the property and having a voice is very different than somebody who's picking almonds and picking grapes, right? So the inputs are very similar, but there's variances that we learn as we did. So I'm doing this now, launched our business in 2015, Recently partnered up with John Deere on a strategic relationship. We've just built a fleet management program, but the fleet program works for every other vendor out there. So that's my background.
That's great. Well, so, you know, given that background and the time that you've been involved in this, you've obviously seen changes within how technology affects the golf operation and golf course. So go back in time a little bit. Tell me, how has it changed, say, in the last decade from what we were doing 10 years ago to where we are right now? What impact have you seen technology have on the golf business?
Well, I think there's just, because of, I'll give this so much credit, you just can't. And I've spoken to users of ours who 6, 7, 8, 9 years ago, without this being prevalent and very friendly, looking at a device and making information from a device and being comfortable, it just wasn't there. So the evolution of that really led to everything on your screen. And this Internet of Thing, it's a techie term, but it's the ability to grab data from, maybe you've heard of machine-to-machine learning. Machine-to-machine learning, which has happened over the last 10, 15 years, it morphed into what this Internet of Things is. And it's really about cloud-enabled data to come together. So whether that's a pump station that's up there, that's a fairway mower that's up there that has cloud enablement to provide hour runtime, GPS, you see a T-sheet program up there. There's a T-sheet program. They have cloud enablement capabilities. So it was the evolution. So the biggest change, you see a drone technology. They're actually a partner of ours. You see all these new technologies that they have open platforms. So they're open to share data with not only their customer, like a soil sensor, not just Dell's property, but he'll share it with, if Dell has another system, go ahead, Dell, you can share that in your other system. You know, in other words, everybody just opened up. We very rarely see a proprietary mentality. And golf had that 5 or 6 years ago.
So,
let me
adjust the mic. So we obviously are changing, but we haven't changed as much as we need to. What areas do you see that golf is kind of lagging behind in terms of technology where we should be, but we aren't there right now?
Well, you know, is the question where or why?
I would say let's go first to where. Okay, where do we need to really focus on, and why do you think we're still kind of behind the curve and everything?
Well, I think if you look at adoption curves in other industries and markets, golf is, without question, one of the slower adoption curves. You know, you start with the early adopters, the early majority, you know, it's still a bell curve, and then you got the majority, and then you got the late majority, and the people that'll never take on the solution. And typically there's a percentage in a market that would quantify being defined as early adopters, and there's a percentage that would be the early majority. You can cut the numbers in golf probably by 2.5-3x just from a mentality. And that mentality comes from something that Fred Real does that I'll have another question on. But I think that's number one. I think that there's a smaller percentage both owner-operator, people that are inside the clubhouse, and definitely a smaller percentage of people outside the golf course, the superintendents and the crew, that have a mentality that we need to change. Now, having said that, it's happened. I mean, I shared my stories where I've been early in the marketplace. I wouldn't believe in being transparent. I'm highly, and our team's highly comfortable that the timing of what we're doing, because of what I just showed you here, because all this stuff enables, all this communication that comes from hardware providers, you know, weather station, pump station, soil sensors, equipment, infrared mapping coming from a drone, all that stuff being able to communicate and bring data into one place. So this is a screenshot of, you know, where does that go and how do you manage that, has
it's, the other doctors have jumped in the last couple of years, and now we're starting to see some early majority starting to jump in. So I think good things are starting to happen.
Okay. And so we all know golf is a very traditional game, very traditional in terms of how we as an industry approach our business. And so, you know, anything that's rooted in tradition, a lot of times kind of, you know, resists change. And certainly technology falls into that. So what do you see are the biggest challenges? You mentioned we really have gotten through the early adopters. What are the challenges for really getting this technology to be consumed by the masses within the golf industry?
Well, I think there's probably three main drivers behind that. I think one, it does start with, there's, I assume most people in the room here are golf course owners or managers. They have the inside of the club, and then you also manage on the outside. Probably fair stuff. It really starts there. The superintendent community is evolving, but they're a very insecure world. They like to say, we're like NFL coaches, but we get paid a lot less. But the insecurity of being able to be fired, most of these guys work without a contract. There is very much this, what I characterize as a upstairs, downstairs, Downton Abbey mentality, that they're downstairs and they're not supposed to intermingle and engage with people upstairs. That's for the club pro to do, not their job. And, you know, they almost become the character, frankly, of, you know, Carl from Caddyshack. And having said that, and I've got a lot of buddies, so I have a lot of buddies from the superintendent world, and I say what I just said with all of them sitting here. There is an evolution of superintendents that are just more comfortable in their skin. They know their stuff. They've got very good communication skills. They're using technology and data to now engage and communicate with their GM, with their committees, their boards. If it's a for-profit business like yours, they're comfortable in dealing with the owner, the CEO, the president, the CFO. There's a percentage of it. And they know it. And, you know, to be candid, one of the reasons they're getting better at it is because it creates security. Because it's very difficult to fire somebody you like and know, right? And perhaps know their wives and perhaps know their families. And I see some of these smart guys that are out there, they're playing golf. The members are, you know, saying, come play with us. I was recently up at a place in Rhode Island, and the superintendent said, you know, do you want to see the course? And we stopped every third hole to say hello to members, and they love this guy. And he's a younger guy, and he was very comfortable doing it. They're saying, hey, we got an opening, you know, next Tuesday to foursome, can you play? So I think that will make a difference, which leads to, you know, this point on tradition, which leads to the membership or the company leadership starting to feel more confident because there's more familiarity to start doing stuff with technology that will have a benefit to the operation, whether it's economical or agronomic. So I think that's one soft.
You know, I think that it's interesting you brought up Carl Spackler from Caddyshack, because I think in my, not speaking for you guys out there, okay, but I think I probably identify much closer to Carl than I do, say, to Doc Brown and Back to the Future. You know, I'm not really that early adopter of technology. So in talking to the people that are here, all right, there's a lot of things to consider in terms of technology and what they want to do. So what would you say is the best thing that they can look to achieve in adopting a higher level of technology at the golf course? What are the things that they really want to achieve in that adoption?
Well, I think first and foremost, it's you want to see an economic growth. I think you want to see the payback on ROI, that's going to vary. Depends on what the technology is. I mean, so soil sensors are becoming prevalent. And candidly, you know, to get into the weeds a little bit, if you're going to water more efficiently, if you're in the West and you have a high dollar cost that comes with your irrigation, you're going to correlate three or four data points, weather data points, and you're going to correlate your soil moisture with those weather variables. And your ultimate goal there is to figure out an optimal soil moisture level. It'll vary by season, and certainly it'll vary by Mother Nature, and that's why you're always going to have this combination of science data as a validator combined with eyeballs. I mean, this is a world where nobody's ever going to sit in an office and say, looks like we're doing okay. We don't need to go out. That day's not going to happen. But the ability to define economics and ROI, so for instance, if we're going to make an investment in, just to use the number, $10,000 worth of sensors, you know, if I was the general manager of the internet, I'd say, you know, okay, what's the expectation of we're going to pay that? So I think they exist. You know, the good news is with a lot of these tools, whether it's a software tool or whether it's hardware tools that are technologies, it exists where you can prove and quantify economic benefits. The second piece is pretty obviously, is this going to help also create more consistent planning conditions? Mm-hmm. Right? I mean, ultimately, if you look at what these guys are tasked to do and what their job is to do, they're tasked to put a consistent, high-quality, playability golf course for people to enjoy. Whether it's a private equity membership club, or it's a resort, or it's a municipality. It's about, frankly, what we have found in our world, because we're about data, it's about consistency more than anything else. You know, some clubs are, you know, higher end, higher budget, and they want to be consistent at their green speeds at 13. Mm-hmm. Some guy, you know, doesn't have that budget, and the type of people who play on the green, we want to be consistent at 9. Mm-hmm. But be consistent. You know, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, Friday, Saturday, Sunday, be consistent. And the data that products like ours have, we have the ability to help them do that. So that would be the second, you know, aspect. So economics first, agronomics second, with planting conditions. And lastly, I throw this out because I think it's relevant. Time management. Time management is a big deal, right? So if you're bringing in technology to your golf course, and the prospects are, I'm going to help the conditioning, and I'm going to help our agronomics. Well, if it's more of a time burden on that superintendent and his crew, that can my guess would be not only would that be detrimental, but at some point in time, because of that, they stop using it. Mm-hmm.
You know, you touched on something that I think is really critical in terms of what I see in the management of our golf courses. And we do know that, you know, we've talked about golf not being an early adopter. We're not quick to adopt technology. It's not because we aren't being marketed by technology companies. I'm telling you, we look at all the time. I know you guys are probably in the same situation. We're getting approached by companies with new apps, point of sale systems. You know, it's actually overwhelming for us to really kind of even try to be up to speed on these type of things.
That's also for stuff inside.
That's exactly right. That's not outside. But at the same time, from a management standpoint, and we're making the decisions, we're trying to evaluate what all of these different return on investments are. You know, we have to try to come up with a way to, how do we evaluate the technology? You know, because that return on investment that you just mentioned is really critical to us. We have to look at it not only from a budgetary standpoint, but for resources. You know, the learning curve for me on adopting new technology, just like you mentioned, the superintendent, if it's too difficult for him to learn, he doesn't do it. And so therefore, whatever the investment you've made in that technology really can be wasted. So take me through what your recommendation is. If we are looking at a new answer or solution from a technology standpoint, what is that decision process? What is the evaluation of technology for whatever particular facility they may be managing that they should do? How do they do that return on investment?
Well, I think two-pronged answer. I think one is what I just said. I think you need the operator to be able to define the economic, agronomic, and time benefits that you're going to make from this capital or operating cost expenditure. Right? Mm-hmm. I think the second thing, I think it's pretty simple. I think just being pragmatic. Who else is using this? Mm-hmm. You know, and ideally, if you're grabbing something from someone that's in the neighborhood that's a user, and you know, I always like, so you're going to get. So anybody that has good technology certainly should have references. And then my recommendation is, when you're talking to those solicited references, that I'd be saying, can you give me some unsolicited users to get the non-solicited references? I just think it's, you know, from a standpoint of time, you can do a paralysis analysis on this stuff sometimes. Pick up the phone and talk to people that are actually using the product, using the solution, and find out what kind of the highs and lows are.
I'm going to switch gears just for a minute here on you. The one thing that we found, you mentioned efficiency, yeah, and then time management, how technology can help us. It's a two-edged sword because a lot of times technology allows us to perform tasks more efficient, but that's also when that technology is working right. You know, we do have instances where the technology isn't necessarily working like it's promised to work. You know, the promised benefits to us don't necessarily work out exactly like they were promised, but really key to that a lot of times is, you know, how much does it require from us in terms of manual input or physical attention to whatever that technology solution is? So what I'd like to get you to do is talk a little bit, if you would, about the importance of automating. And you talked about machine learning. You know, let's delve into that a little bit. Tell us a little bit more about what does it really entail to get that learning process automated so it's not requiring somebody to sit there and manually enter that data?
Well, a couple answers on this. I would say that, again, from the standpoint of people who are utilizing new technologies as they become available in the marketplace and getting valued and actually using it and therefore getting valued, I think a couple things on that. One is that there's a lot of technologies, right? So, and in terms of the comment about some things sometimes don't work, it's true. Sometimes the sensor gives a faulty reading, but you're also, you know, Toro's and John Deere's equipment at time have issues. You know, I mean, that's life, right? Mm-hmm. You have products that, from time to time, whether they're new stuff in the market or they're old stuff in the market, you know, you're going to have stuff you have to fix. Mm-hmm. Right? So I don't know necessarily if that's a new technology phenomenon, but you know, the question of how do you know you're going to be able to maximize the automation of it? Mm-hmm. Well, that is, again, to my upfront point, this IoT machine-to-machine market's enabled that, right? So an operating platform like OnLink, there's certain things that we can automate because it's the stuff out on the course that enabled it. So I'll make it simple. Weather, water, chemical ferts, labor, equipment, and then, you know, on the far right, we call that playability, playing condition, right? So if you guys have golf courses that, where you're taking data, so we run into a lot of people that are doing Excel spreadsheets, right? So they're spreadsheeting themselves to death. And quite frankly, when we come in and we see that, we're like, we got it, you know, because it's laborious. You can't get reports quickly out of it. They're not getting any automation. They're, you know, Excel spreadsheet's not grabbing pump station consumptive use and converting it from gallons to dollars, right, that a software package is going to do. You know, they are getting their weather station information, but the problem with the weather station information by itself is that it sits over here by the maintenance shed, and I got property all over the place. You know, so it's the relevance of it, you know, frankly, diminishes. We hear it, so this is not. So there's limitations there, but there's automation. All the sensor stuff now is automated. It's all Bluetooth enabled, where it's wireless, and it's feeding something back to an internet. There's certain things, hypothetically, people who are reporting green speeds, not taking green speeds, reporting green speeds, right? For what? For recipes. So, you know, the good operators out there, I am building my recipes so I can see day by day, week by week, when I had good conditions, what fell in place. I see what my weather variables were. I see what my soil conditions variables were. I see what my water output was. I know what my growth regulator output was prior to that day. Did I spray? Did I not spray? What did I spray? What was my height of cut? How did I run my labor pool? So if you can grab, we're working with PGA on a recipe for tournaments. But it's the same thing. If you can grab for, you know, the PGA, tour event, you know, it's as good as any golf course club, private resort or public, to try to get that, you know, that record keeping for consistency. Some of the stuff is going to be automated. Pump stations have cloud-enabled stuff to bring up consumptive using gallons. Software converts it into dollars. You've got a running program that gives you thresholds. At 75% of my water budget for the month, can I do anything? Maybe not. But it's through a text.
And if you don't have enablement for your pump station, well, instead of somebody going down there to the pump station and writing down what it did this morning or what it did last night or yesterday for 24 hours, and then when he gets a chance to go back into the office to tap it in, and there's human error there as well, you know, modern day products have the ability to just tap it into the phone. And same thing with green speeds. If you're recording green speeds, you're just tapping into the phone. So there's, in the world I've seen, it's getting better and better and better for automation. Mm-hmm. But there are some things. So I'll give you a great example. Labor. Labor's everything for everybody, right? There's a program out there where you can track estimate to action to see if you're really forecasting well. So, for instance, 5 hours for your crew to mow greens in the morning. You assign them 5 hours, four guys on that. And then right next to it, there's an action. So when they're done, somebody can go into the phone, it's usually an assistant out there, he can tap into the phone. It was not 4 hours, it was what we estimated, it was 4.2. Right? So now you're starting to see deltas. Whole point is best practices, you know, figuring out how to optimize, optimize the route out there. But it's manual. How will it become automated? There's sensors out there right now. You guys might be using them. They're using them on the back of bags. So it's a GPS. And that GPS can go in a belt loop of a human being, a worker, right? And the timestamp, so you can see somebody moving, you know, from one location to another, and now all of a sudden you have an automation that time. Mm-hmm. So he didn't have to tap the 4 hours was. I mean, look, they're all trying to say 4 hours, but I went down to 3.8.
That's that's great. And it really is amazing the potential we have for being able to operate more efficiently out there. Again, coming back to a Carl Spackler like me, you know, going from my level to a George Jetson is not something that I'm probably going to be able to make in one leap. All right, and I would imagine it probably varies from facility to facility, but looking at adopting technology, is it feasible, is it possible in the outside operation of the course to kind of more or less stick your toes in the water? Can you go and say, okay, we're going to just do just this part and see how that goes and then kind of make that gradual change?
So walk your mind.
Yes.
Yeah, it is. I mean, that's the good news. There's, you know, I think the decision tree is what's important to your values, right? I mean, I don't know where everybody's from, but, you know, we're working with customers, users that are from, you know, the West Coast to the Southwest, Southeast, Northeast, Midwest, et cetera. And, you know, climate, soil types, all those things come into play. And therefore, what's important to them, in terms of what I want to try first, can vary. Having said that, you know, 55 to 60, I think the real number is 62% of whether it's a, you know, a top 100 type of golf course private, or it's a, you know, a municipality, you know, at 350 in budget or 500,000. Labor is everything. So, I would think, you know, there's labor programs out there that are affordable, and they're powerful. They give you record keeping. They're easy to set up. You can get great reports from them. You can share them. Everything's cloud enabled. You're actually more efficient than what they're doing with a whiteboard right now that gets erased, which means you don't have any record keeping for that. Mm-hmm. Right? So. To what's important to you. I mean, if you don't have any soil sensors, you know, maybe that's for somebody who's had agronomic issues going on out there, where they're interested in better water management, whether it's for water cost savings or it's for agronomic purposes. Maybe start with a sensor or two, buy two sensors. And from that, you're having a good experience, you're getting the information, you're making decisions off it that have an impact, and then maybe from there you take on the labor.
Mm-hmm. You make a really good point. You stimulated my thinking here. This is we're getting off the script a little bit.
I don't know the charge I should put up.
Well, the reality is, you know, you mentioned something that just dawned on me. I'm in Charlotte, North Carolina. You know, and quite honestly, water use in our area is not a real big issue. You know, we water's pretty plentiful. We have access to it. But if you take someone that's in an area where they're paying for water. You know, being able to accurately monitor and manage and control the cost of that water obviously would be a higher priority for them than it would be for me. But labor is certainly something that we all have. I'm just curious, anybody out here in the room who lives in an area or has a course in an area where the water use and water restrictions are really kind of restricted. So what kind of solutions are you using currently in your technology on that?
Well, we just kind of dialed that. We were mandated by the state to reduce water by 25% over three year ago now span. I'm not in charge of maintenance, but it's a big company, but they were able to get it done. They basically almost turned off all the water in the unplayable areas of the course, so mm-hmm. those triangles work. So they kind of cut back there, cut back on the grad drain and the battle back. We were brown last year. Not horrendous, but I think it was most of
it. And again, come back to what Walt said, I'm just really curious because it seems like it'd be a great thing to have you kind of real-time reporting of where you are in the water budget to know, all right, we got a little bit of extra or we're free, we can water a little more this week. Or
he knows levels of the gallon. We pump it out of the ground, but some of it's infused with city water.
Yeah.
So we do have to reduce. We have a situation that actually kind of works out of our favor. 2 years ago when we were running off metering, our pump station caught on fire, so we actually hooked up to a fire hydrant and we're tapping that for half a month.
Mm-hmm.
So our meter usage was way, way down.
Yeah. Good way to say it.
Where are you located?
Anaheim, California.
Yeah. You know, I've seen golf course, a lot of golf course operators are purely innovative. I've seen that. We actually had a facility I worked with one time just on a consulting basis, and they had managed to somehow they had tapped into the city water without a meter. And so they were running the whole irrigation without a meter on the property. You know, it was a private club, and question. So that was the way that it was. So how about labor? I'm curious about labor too. Or do we have anybody in the audience out here that's currently using some technology to manage labor costs, particularly on the downside operations? Yes, sir.
It's not really super sophisticated, like you said. We keep really close track of everything. All the suits now, you know, they can tell you every day how much water they use and what their plan is for the rest of the month, and they can tell you that they can monetize that in their head pretty easily because they have to, right? Same with labor. We did an NPS study, and we continue to fine tune it, and it gets put up, and we use. Televisions and electronic, you know, communication of tasks, and you know, it's up from American Golf. So we've got a lot of this stuff, but to your point, it's kind of piecemeal. They're individual pieces, and I would say there's some modernization in how we do it, but there's no automation in it. And I guess I'm struggling trying to figure out. How we would get that to work, right? We manage a lot of older municipal facilities, public side anyway, and even a lot of privates. They're older irrigation systems, older maintenance buildings. We struggle with connectivity out to a lot of these buildings as it is now. I see the benefit in all of it. I'm trying to figure out how we would ROI, how would we go about figuring out how this would actually, it's going to save time, I get that, but there's going to be a lot more than just software. I mean, we've got pump stations that are ancient, and they're not going to talk to anything.
So my answer to that is, I'm not here to talk about what we do, but we do aggregate all the data in one place, and we get the features and thresholds and alarms, and to put something down, you get alert. We don't have people looking at this all the time, but we think that, frankly, that course that you have with that budget and some of the limitations you have from a budgetary standpoint, they need these efficiency tools more than people who have 5x that budget.
I would agree with that.
And, we have a Billy Beane Lane Ball thing, which, do more with less. You just have to be smart about how you kind of walk into it. If I want to have data and I want to have information so I can make better water decisions or chemical decisions or labor decisions or equipment management decisions, how do I, how do you inexpensively get in the car, right? And my point to you would be, look at what you're trying to solve first.
So if it's water, you know, what kind of a tool, tools perhaps, enable you to more intelligently look at information that would help you perhaps be more efficient in water? You know, water, as you know, is tied to weather variables. It's tied mostly to your soil variables. And of course, it's tied to whether you have a good irrigation system, right? Which sounds like that's your, one of your challenges.
Often.
What's that?
Often it's a challenge for us.
Yeah. And if it's labor, it sounds like you've figured some things out. I mean, there's some good labor programs out there that will help time management, give you good record keeping. I don't think frankly, we have a very good labor program. I don't think we're going to save people money with our labor program. I think they're going to manage more efficiently, more than anything else. I think they're going to manage smarter with it. They might. There's an OT, overtime threshold alert program. So when somebody's trending to 50% of their budget or 75% of their budget, they get a text alert. They might be able to do something, you know, with that knowledge and let somebody go, or because of what's going on, they have to keep it and hit the overtime.
So does anyone use technology currently in their labor to track that? I mean, I'm really interested in the. So I'll confess, I'm a spreadsheet guy, and we have excess spreadsheets out there. So the truth is, we're always using our formulas for what the times should be for our laborers to do certain tasks, get mowed greens, fairways rough, whatever that might be. And, you know, it's a monumental task for us to go into what we have and try to analyze that and see, are we even kind of close to hitting those numbers? You know, forget about the times when, you know, the mower breaks down or something happens with a tree over on 17, you know, the guys have to stop what they're doing and do that. Forget all of that. You know, just tracking that is just a monumental task. Does anybody here have that level of tracking on their label right now that they can do that? A lot of potential. The reality is it's interesting. I love to be able to have that. So again, that comes back to the whole efficiency thing. You know, are we really able to deliver on what we're basing our budgets on? It would be great to see something like that. And that just brings up a question I've had for you. And something like that, you know, the unexpected are things. And this is again off script here, Walt. I know I can throw this stuff out to you. Unexpected occurrences happen all the time on the golf course. Now, from labor to things like golf cart fleet management, you know, carts breaking down and everything, talk a little bit about how is technology impeded by that, or does it actually help make the operation better when you have those unexpected things? Does it throw kind of a wrench in the whole gears that kind of ripples through all the technology, or how do you see instances like that dropping up affecting?
Well, I think it helps it because, again, assuming the operation has to happen. So, you know, for instance, good fleet management programs that are well done, easy to use, and they integrate up your service and maintenance schedules, they integrate up the operating manual, so you're taking care of your equipment, and you're getting the programs out there, you literally get notified that fairway mower is hitting its 1,000 hours scheduled to come in, and then that will also prompt same system to say we have the parts and components for that service, and if not, it goes into an order management with an override between the superintendent and the mechanic, and then the part comes in, right? And so that way you're taking care of the equipment on time, there's knowledge, there's record keeping, ultimately that cost of ownership, and then you've got the R&M, you've got the operator, you've got the mechanic's time. If you have something that has a tight band around it, that you're taking care of that machine and those machines in an efficient way, and you've got qualified operators. So there's programs out there where if you put an operator on a hypothetically a fairway mower, he's not certified. That software will tell you. You just put somebody on there that's not certified, mm-hmm. which goes to performance, mm-hmm. which goes to care of the equipment, right? And therefore the cost of the equipment. Mm-hmm. So that's an analogy of where technology would help that,
right?
Because you're running that kind of level of an organization. Mm-hmm. Labor's labor,
right?
You know, even though you have the ability to allocate it and true to actual, you know, like time to do bunker work, and time that I'm estimated to do, you know, low range work, you know, hypothetical storm claims. Even if you find that's a delegate, this market across the country, if there's one thing that is the common threat, is that quality labor is efficient. I don't think technology solves that problem.
Yeah. So in that, and this is a question I've got for the audience here, because I know one of the things that I've seen, and you know, the challenges we face as an industry are addressed in a lot of ways by different facilities, different levels of the segmentation where they sit in the market. How many of you here have a full-time mechanic at your golf course now? Okay, and so we might be, you know, we have a number here that don't even have that position at their golf course. And that's one of the things that I have seen has kind of gone away. You know, we're one of the efficiencies that we have because we have multiple courses is we don't have a mechanic at every course. We're actually able to share a mechanic, you know, and that helps out a lot. But that is one of the things that you really need that type of person. I'm also curious too, because this is another thing I see commonly, currently on your equipment, if you've got a capital equipment inventory, how are you tracking, how many are using a spreadsheet right now to track that? Okay, so you give your superintendent or whoever your equipment manager is, mechanic, whoever's in charge of that, they go out and they take the spreadsheet, you do an audit, or you basically do an inspection. How many times, somebody throw it out, how often do you actually, just go out and physically do an inventory of your equipment, do conditioning, age, maintenance records and things like that? Somebody tell me.
Quarterly?
That's actually really good.
And we use TurfCentric, so, you know, as far as maintenance, it's all managed daily. Like,
right.
You know, but it's quarterly.
Brings up a good question. How open is your architecture with what you're doing today to use information from basically any type of a program or source like that? Is it proprietary, or are you open to other?
No, it's open as well. Well, I honestly couldn't hear you. Did you mention the program you're using?
Yeah, TurfCentric. I mean, okay. For the equipment.
Yeah, I mean, if you switched over to our program, we would grab you. You still have all that historical data, right? Quite frankly, we haven't been approached with it, but you know, that could become an integration part. Mm-hmm. In other words, instead of using our system, you can use our entire platform and continue with them, and we feed the reports. We do have, as I said, up front, I should have said this, think of iOS, Android app. You've got a bunch of non-Apple apps on this, and you've got a lot of Apple apps as well. That's who we are. So if somebody has a good program and a user likes it, we'll integrate that.
So I want to ask you to kind of put on, we've talked a lot about where technology was, we've talked a lot about where technology currently is. I want you to kind of put on your cap, your crystal ball, and tell us 5 years from now, 10 years from now, where is technology going to be? What type of things will we see on the golf course 5 or 10 years from now?
Well, to start that, I'm going to digress because I got to get this slide in here to put together.
All right.
So when I first came into this industry, and I mentioned that Paul Latchell story. I saw for the first time Paul really pulling up the soil, and pulling it out and snowing it, and then really putting it on his tongue. So I think the evolution of that with everything that I've shown you up here, all this, Internet of Things, machine to machine, this communication thing that's happened that creates this, segues to, this is a report, here's a 6-month rolling report for everything on the golf course and what influences cost as well as performance. It's data, and it's 4 weather variables, 2 soil variables, and rounds played, right? All those things impact performance. The evolution to us, to me, this is my opinion, is here. It's artificial intelligence. Transparently, I tell everybody that we're working with one of the biggest brands in the world, bringing this into golf next year. And it shouldn't spook anybody in the room. AI has been successfully used in other industries, and the values that have been received are just come. It is the evolution of everything we do as human beings in our daily lives to businesses. We're all about businesses. And so what is really the value, and why does this make a difference? You talk about automation. Now, you do have to have data. So again, get it out of a spreadsheet, get it into a real software program, let that AI program, we're working with Watson from IBM, let the Watson thing through weather, because what creates more variability on cost and performance on anybody's golf course in this room, it's weather. So they bought the weather company, $6.5 billion, which gives you a perspective on how big weather is in the world. And so we're bringing it in through the weather group. And the end value, whether it's 2 years from now, 5 years from now, 10 years from now, and I know it does sound grotesque, but it's happening now in other industries, it's the ability to profile how you've been watering, what your weather conditions have been, what's your height cut on your equipment, what's your fertilization program been in the last 30 days, have you had any disease, have you treated disease, take clipping yields, what are your clipping yields, what are your soil moisture, what are your soil temperature. So it'll take about every variable that you have, and it's a super brain. And it'll look at patterns and profiles, and normally it comes out, and it's, we should put this in our water. We suggest. We have to be careful. Everybody's got to be careful about liability stuff. It's got to be a recommendation. But that's what it is. It's. I see this being an audio. I see the day coming where the operators, you in the room, as well as your superintendents, trust it. And when it's trusted, because right now you have programs like ours where you have to have a superintendent that has to correlate those three or four weather variables with my soil conditions, with my green speeds, with my clipping yields, and what am I doing right, what am I doing wrong? So you've got a human being that has to do that. We have some smart guys, so they are able to do that. It's a threshold. Now you have the computer brain, right? And then they're good. And so it goes to optimization, performance optimization of how you water, how you run your equipment, probably how you move your labor. So that would be the biggest, broadest evolution, I think. And it's interesting because golf doesn't get this type of technology to come into it, can it? I mentioned earlier that ag does. It's already in ag. This is already in ag. Ag has, they have many more data collectors than we have in golf. Good news in golf, it's getting better. There are more companies coming in. They're seeing the activity. It's almost like they're seeing this industry come out of dormancy, right? And let's jump in and let's try to help. So I think broadly AI, we work with John Deere. I mean, they already have driverless, equipment, obviously, in the ag space. I know on a beta basis they're doing driverless, equipment for green cars, right? So I do think that takes place. What does that mean? 55%, 62% of labor, all of this starts to come down.
So good news out here is artificial intelligence doesn't mean we're going to have Arnold Schwarzenegger looking Terminators rolling out there, right? We're going to get some benefits from this.
I actually think a lot about this.
So do you envision, let's talk about, you mentioned the GPS motors, right? And we've actually seen some beta testing. Does anybody have that level of equipment? Is anybody using GPS kind of mowing equipment on their courses right now? Do you see that being something that's going to be feasible for as an industry standard almost?
I do. I think it's like kind of Sirius XM when it first came out. That none of the vehicles you had to retrofit, right? And then over a period of time, people said, I want to do my vehicle, so they built it in. The good news, look, every industry benefits from competition, and two biggest players on the equipment side are the green and the red guys, and they see the evolution. Deere has an advantage because they see all the stuff going on in the much bigger ag division, right? And they get the benefits of a lot of that innovation and that R&D. I think it'll be common. I think I don't have a crystal ball in it, but my swag would be in the next 5 years, you're going to see GPS systems on a lot of these equipments, whether it's new OEM machines or it's retrofit. And they're going to make it affordable. That's the good thing about competition. Right.
two players, and the third player will jump in, and it'll drive down price, and that will drive up adoption. Mm-hmm.
So let's open it up for a minute. Anybody have some questions? Yes, sir, Ted.
Moving maybe a little away, and not as agronomy based, but hoping to put your IBM innovation hat on or your entrepreneur hat on, sort of other ways that IoT will start to take over, and of course, maybe direct with the consumer, whether it's checking in, but we'd love to hear your thoughts.
I'm sorry, could you repeat that, please?
So IoT, how do you see that sort of taking over, of course, potentially with it?
So how would paraphrase your question, how would the consumer benefit from all this data that's now being utilized in the golfers?
Yes, or how can the course benefit from, how can the course start using IoT to gather consumer data? If you have any ideas on that or thoughts?
Unfortunately, I'm not here at the moment.
So what you're asking, I'm going to jump in and try to help you here, Tim. He's asking, are there consumer-facing benefits to the Internet of Things and adoption of the golf courses that, you're basically tying together all the information from an operational standpoint. Now, one of the things that, and when you look at consumer-facing, you are tying into the point-of-sale system. You are connecting into that and pulling information out of that. Is there an opportunity to expand that into the consumer experience of the golf course?
I think there is. I'm sorry, I couldn't hear you.
Thank you.
There is. We're getting ready to integrate with it. In fact, I will tell you that when I first started this, people were telling me you could develop on the clock, right? And then, candidly, I looked, because nobody's touched this outside. You know, it's like, here's a wall, and everything's dark out there. No, there's just no data. There's no information. And no communication between, ABC and BC. We're getting ready to integrate, because our customers want us to, with a company called Club Central. They're on 2,500 private golf clubs. And, they have an accounting program, they have a POS system, they have an F&B system, they have a CRM website program. So we're going to integrate with them. And really, that value prop for the mutual customers, we have mutual customers, is that the GM or the CEO of the board, they can now see everything in one place, right? I mean, I think that's really the biggest value prop to that. To the consumer being the golfer, it's an interesting one. Well, and boy, the superintendents don't like this idea, but we have the ability with our, so we have T-sheet partners. And so and we grab their data. So our superintendent group wants to see on their phone who's playing today, so they can look at project work. They can look at, I've got a bunch of 18 handicaps compared to a bunch of five. So maybe I can get ahead of some of these 18s, and I got to watch it, when these fives come around. Or they look for gaps in play, so they go out there and do some stuff. And some of these guys are pretty relationship savvy. They look at it as a CRM. I see Mr. Smith playing today, and I'm trying to get in his good graces. I'm going to go see him on the 13th. The club also came back to us. We've had two of these happen. They've come back and said, can we get your playing condition, speed and firmness, onto our website with your weather? So we've got this special weather program with the IBM TWC guys. With that, so when they come in, they can see, I'm teeing off at 9 o'clock, and the last green speed reading, which was that day, it was 11.5, firmness was 0.35. Somebody has to figure out in the real world, consumer world, what a firmness, measurement means, and then, rain at this time, winds of this, humidity levels, etc. That would be one example. Does that answer your question?
Yeah. No, it's a good idea.
Somebody else? Anybody else have any questions for Walt? Anything we've talked about or things we haven't talked about? Pretty quiet crowd. Well, I'll tell you what we could do. We had said when we first started into this, we thought it would take us to maybe right at an hour, maybe just a little bit over that, and we've done that. So, we'll still be around up here for a few minutes. If you guys would like to go ahead and go on out on a break, you can. We'll have, yes, sir, Rock.
Morning, my lady. Do you find any specific apps that they're using for the labor or for the equipment? I mean, I've heard this doing right here, say one of them. Does anybody have anything that they're using that you can share? I mean, it's not advertising or anything. any tools that you're using at your facility that you're willing to share that, that you found useful.
Well, I'm gonna step up and I'm gonna say something. Does that surprise you? And this is actually before I even got involved. You know, one of the things that we've got five courses that we manage, and so obviously equipment is a big issue for us. You know, we share equipment across courses. You know, if we have a problem with the mower over on this course, you know, we'll steal one from this course and go back and forth. And one of the things I really found that was difficult was keeping track of that equipment. Where does it go? Where does it live? Who's responsible for it? Once it goes to a certain place, you know, what happens to it? Because we were working on the spreadsheets and everything. So we actually did develop in-house. I developed and worked with a gentleman of mine, a friend of mine. We actually have a software developed. We developed a tracking app for that, basically. It's equipment, you know. So we use that. We found it to be very useful. And one of the keys to it, and Walt's alluded to it a lot right here, are these things. You know, beforehand, it didn't make a lot of sense for us to try to delegate out responsibility and stuff like that. It was much better to have one person who is in charge, and basically you own this piece of equipment. This is, you know, if you're a superintendent at XYZ course, you own that, and it's your responsibility to keep track of where the piece of equipment is. But now we actually created an app, and everybody on the grounds crew has that app. They have their own login, and so they are responsible for that piece of equipment. So at any time, they can actually do a thing on it where they can show us the condition of that equipment. They can take a picture, and it actually geotags where that piece of equipment is. And it's all kept in a timeline, like kind of like Facebook, you know, so you can go back and you can see the history of that machine. Here, it was here, it was there, it was here, it was there.
Alert, maintenance, preventive maintenance.
Maintenance, it does, it's got a maintenance thing in it. So, you know, you put in, you know, now none of my equipment has ours where we actually communicate, you know, with the Internet of Things, but we put in alerts, and we have to do it by time. You know, we estimate, okay, if this mower needs an oil change every so many hours, and we know that mower gets used X number of hours, you know, we kind of do a swag and just say, okay, at this point in time is when that machine is due for maintenance, and it will alert the superintendent, you know, that's piece of equipment scheduled for maintenance. And then once the maintenance is performed, you could actually go in and record when the day the maintenance was performed and everything too.
Just FYI for everybody, our company at 245 today, and I don't know what room, we're doing about a 1 hour presentation if anybody wants to see the labor, the equipment, the camper, it'd be great.
And you know, it's like everything else with technology. We were very to have walked up here, and we have you know, kind of tapped his brain and everything. It's really interesting that there's just tons of solutions out there. A lot of times the questions that we asked him, I think, were very relevant, because it comes down to, you know, how applicable is this solution to my unique facility, my unique situation? You know, are these benefits and return on investment worthwhile for him? And so, you know, while you've got him here, I would encourage you, you know, if you got anything that you want to talk to him about, he is just an incredible wealth of knowledge and is certainly willing to share that knowledge with you on virtually any facet of your operation. So, again, we'll stick around for a few minutes afterwards. Anything you'd like to go on out and get an early start, we'll let you get on in there for the break. And then I think the session start back up, both in the same three rooms that we've got right now, about 10:45, something like that.
Thank you very much.
Yeah, thank you.